Thank you very much for inviting me to present this on the vitrectomy for PDR. And these are my financial disclosures. Proliferative diabetic retinopathy with its associated complications forms a major indication for pars plana vitrectomy, and progression of PDR often occurs despite a well-formed performed panretinal photocoagulation. These, as we all know, are the classical indications for vitrectomy in proliferative diabetic retinopathy, and these are some of the newer ones, as was being discussed here by Dr. Gigalotra. Progressive fulminant neovascularization or active severe PDR is an indication for early vitrectomy, dense premacular hemorrhages, and progressive macular traction. And this is what majority of all vitrectomy nowadays are performed for, in our experience, and not really for vitreous hemorrhage. The important principle, first principle to remember, is do not think any diabetic vitrectomy is a simple vitrectomy, even if you just see vitreous hemorrhage, which is fairly mobile on the ultrasound. There's almost always never a posterior vitreous detachment, and if it looks like an apparent PVD, always suspect vitrectomy. So these are the sort of cases that now can come up for surgery, where you see the initially the more neovascularization and going into fibrosis here. These are active, angry new vessels where we often use Avastin preoperatively to reduce the vascularity and then operate. And this is the late fibrotic stage where you have a tabletop traction detachment. The other important principle is to intervene early when the adhesions are less extensive and tight, the retina is healthier anatomically and functionally, and the optic nerve also is usually more healthy. And the key to successful membrane surgery lies in the correct identification of the posterior hyoid face and the plane of dissection. And that comes through the always being alert about the possibility of vitrectomy. This is the classical diagram where you see, possibly think this is the posterior vitreous detachment, but actually this is the schistous cavity and the hyoid is only separating in this area. So the trick is to try and find this area where there is actually a separation already between the posterior hyoid and the retina. In this coming video, it's a compilation of cases, and we'll go through some of these concepts. This is not triamcinolone. This patient had asteroid, and that is sort of guiding you to where the posterior vitreous detachment is. So that can be a sort of spontaneous staining you're getting. This is a video which shows the concept of the vitrectomy I was talking about. You seem to have gone through the posterior hyoid, but when you pick up that edge and start removing it, this is not actually a PDR. This is a VMT case, but just to illustrate that principle. And you see that another membrane getting lifted up when you're pulling on that apparent posterior edge of the hyoid. And then you see that this is the second layer which is separated, and actually that is the true posterior hyoid. One could argue that maybe the other layer was the internal limiting membrane, but that really isn't so, because as you see subsequently, once we've got this off and you put brilliant blue, and then you get the third layer, which is actually the internal limiting membrane. There you can see very well the internal limiting membrane now coming off and leaving these typical punctured hemorrhages on the surface, which is typical of when you are peeling the ILM. Here this is a full-blown classic tabletop traction detachment, advanced TRD, and this is again finding the correct plane. This apparently seems to be the edge, but that's not really. The hyoid is extending further anteriorly along this, and you have to get into that correct plane there. And once you're in the correct plane, the dissection then proceeds much more effortlessly and quickly, and you can see each point of connection between that and the retina, and then proceed further. once you're working bimanually in these large traction detachments and this large fibrotic membranes, you can use the cutter often as a second instrument. You can use it to separate the membrane and also cut it. And that's where MIVS, again, the micro incision, has made it simpler, because with a 23 or a 25 now, even we're doing these cases with 25 gauge cutters, you can the tissue planes, then the larger cutter. This is a classic forceps and scissor dissection. Here you see you're working actually along that large temporal arcade vessel, but once you lift up this membrane, you can see each point connection and confidently cut it without pressing trauma to that major vessel or having any bleeding. This was an interesting case. Again, this was a PDR and had this large membrane all over the posterior pole. But the interesting thing in this was that was alongside this, there was a macular hole also. Sometimes you can iatrogenically create one when you are removing the membrane, and if there's an attachment at the fovea, we have had cases where a hole formed during the procedure, and then you sort of proceed with the ILM peel and gas and treat it as a macular hole. But one had a pre-existing. Here you see we're doing with the cutter and a scissor combination of bimanual, and then putting a brilliant blue. That's the macular hole. And then you do the classic ILM peel. In these cases, a little more difficult than in macular hole situations, because the retina is not healthy. It's boggy often. So the ILM, and you can't use a tano. You it's always almost mandatory that you do it with the forceps, the pinch and peel technique. This was a case, again, when you operate, this is the advantage. This was an active disease still, but here you can induce a posterior vitreous detachment almost as you do in a classic, say, a macular hole case. And here the hyoid came off, but you're not generally so lucky in most of the cases. But here the vitreous, the posterior hyoid separated nicely, and such a case can finish off quite fast. It's already well lasered, so there's not much to do after this. Hemostasis, again, sometimes you can have persistent troublesome bleeders which don't stop even when you elevate the bottle, and you don't want to do too long, so... Sorry? And there we use a combination of passive extrusion with the cautery, and here we are using pressure from the... cutter to and if you just press over the bleeder and stay there for say a minute and a half to two, many of the times the bleeding will stop, and that's better for the nerve than to raise the bottle height too much. This is an endo laser. You can do a complete this thing with scleral depression right out to the periphery, or you can use it LIO. You could also complete the endo laser under air if the retina is little elevated. So you do the fluid air exchange and then complete the laser. Thank you for your attention.